7 Pacific, will go live to Capitol Hill in a hearing by the House Foreign Affairs Committee to look at foreign policy priorities for 1990. The committee is set to take testimony from Secretary of State Baker, who will talk about the defense budget for the next fiscal year. The U.S. House of Representatives will meet this morning at 11 a.m. Eastern Time, and C-SPAN will bring you gavel-to-gavel coverage of the proceedings. There is no legislative business scheduled for today, and members may adjourn early. Finally, join us this evening at 6:30 Eastern Time, when the topic of our first call-in program will be a report recently released by the U.S. government to look at smoking and its effects. A representative from the Center for Disease Control will be our guest. And that's a brief look at what's coming up here on C-SPAN. Thank you for watching.
At the end of each week, the top news stories are reviewed by a group of journalists and C-SPAN viewers. Tune in for a re-air of the Journalist Roundtable call-in program, Saturdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Time, 6 p.m. on the West Coast.
Continue our morning call-in programs now as the topic turns to Black history. Our guest is Susan McHenry, the managing editor of Emerge magazine. She joins us to talk about the 25th anniversary of the assassination of Malcolm X, and we'll take your questions and comments on her new magazine. Susan McHenry of Emerge magazine, how do you grade the media on its coverage of Black Americans?
Well, it has gotten better since the 50s and 60s when you didn't see us at all. But I think one of the problems that we see, and the reason there is a need for an Emerge magazine, is that you tend to see coverage on the pathologies of the Black community. And certainly, those are things worth attention, but it doesn't give you the full range of what the Black community is about. And that is why we're working on a general interest magazine called Emerge, Our Voice in Today's World.
We'll get into that in a little bit and show our viewers some of the covers. Some critics have pointed to, for example, the Boston Globe's coverage of the recent Charles Stewart case in Boston as a case of uncritical reporting. How would you react to that?
Well, actually, that's very complicated because I'm aware that there were Black reporters involved as well. I think it's a case of being swept along with the story and with a trend of the story rather than stopping to ask the really hard questions. So, like I say, it's a little more complicated, I think, than just carelessness.
Good morning again from Washington. Our guest for the next 45 minutes is Susan McHenry. She is the managing editor of Emerge magazine. I'll hold it up for our viewers to see. Ms. McHenry previously was the editor of Meeting Destinations, a business travel monthly, and she was also the senior editor of Ms. magazine from 1978 till 1987. She also wrote articles on employment and work options for Ms., New Choices, and Savvy Women. Tell us about Emerge magazine. What was the concept in developing this magazine?
Well, the concept, Wilmer C. Ames, Jr., who is a longtime journalist in the Time, Inc. organization, he worked for both Sports Illustrated and Time magazine, came up with this idea 6 or 7 years ago, and he had been working on it practically full-time for the last 5 years. It's a magazine to address a rising generation of Black professionals. Those of us who have been beneficiaries of all the hard work of previous generations, pushing away legal segregation and legal barriers to moving around freely in the society. One of the things, and the other I think motivating force behind Emerge was the sense that right now, up to this point, the black reading public has been addressed as a mass audience, as a sort of this monolithic group of people, when in fact we're a very, very diverse group of folks. And there are different segments in the black population, just like there are different segments in the white population, and a variety of interests. And Wilmer identified that there was not a vehicle addressed to a black audience that was strictly a reader's magazine, was a magazine that was devoted to sophisticated commentary and an aggressive journalistic perspective on our experience, from our perspective.
How do you go about deciding what articles or what type of articles you'll have in each magazine? I notice in the most recent one you have articles about Bryant Gumbel, rap music, politics. How do you go about deciding what will be in an issue?
Well, it is a general interest magazine, so that gives us a very, very broad field to address. And I think in every issue you'll definitely find articles about politics, articles about culture, articles about topical personalities that are of interest to the black community. You'll find news articles that are driven about what's happening in the news, and articles about difficult social problems that we are rightly obsessed with right now.
And in this month's, February's issue, the cover story is about Malcolm X 25 years later. What kind of response are you getting to the magazine? And
actually, it turns out that this Malcolm X issue is the most popular so far. This is our fourth issue. And it's been selling out in various places around the country. And I think what it has to do with a resurgence of interest in this figure who was assassinated, taken from us 25 years ago, just yesterday. He was a very misunderstood person, but he had a message about self-determination and a message about pride and dignity. And actually, the current young generation, teenagers and people in their early 20s, have sort of turned to him as a cult figure. And what we wanted to do in this issue was to look at the man and his legacy and examine a little bit about why, you know, 25 years later, he has a hold on the popular imagination in the African-American community.
To our viewers, we'll be going to your phone calls in just a few moments. You'll see the numbers on the bottom of the screen. If you're in Eastern or Central time zones, the number to use is 202-628-2525, Mountain and Pacific 202-783-2727, and we'll get to your calls in just a minute. What is your circulation like at this point after 4 months?
Well, we have a target circulation of 150,000. We want a base of 150,000 readers, and we are making good progress toward that, both in newsstand sales and subscriptions. So, and then also apparently a very wide sort of impact pass along wise. You know, lots of folks sharing different same copies of the magazine.
You mentioned that the founder felt that there wasn't a niche quite being covered by this magazine or by other magazines. How does it differ from, say, Ebony magazine?
Well, Ebony magazine, of course, was conceived as a picture magazine, and it was conceived as a magazine to, as I said, for a mass audience, the sort of widest possible base. And, you know, in that context, you're not going to have in that format, you're not going to have the room or the breadth to really take on hard news reporting articles. It's more of a picture and feature magazine, and we of course we're also interested in the way we look, and we are very interested in photojournalism, and that is I think a hallmark of the way our book looks. But we pay a lot of attention to the writers. We use the best writers in the country, people like Pulitzer Prize winning Clarence Page, George Curry, Juan Williams, Michelle Wallace, Joel Dreyfus, who is a contributing editor to the magazine. We have an opportunity to use the best talent out there that there is. And what's interesting is that, for a very new magazine, we immediately got the interest of these writers who are very eager and enthusiastic to contribute to our pages.
For any new magazine, the first struggle seems to be getting advertising. How is your magazine doing on that front?
The first issue of the magazine, we had 19 pages of advertising, which is a pretty amazing debut. Also considering the tiny staff that we had going after that. And we hope to build up from there.
How big is your staff right now?
For the entire magazine, including the editorial operation and the business operation, there are a grand total of 20 of us. That's pretty amazing for an 80 or 90 page book that we put out every month.
Let's take a call from St. Paul, Minnesota. Go ahead, please.
Ms. McHenry, I'm very interested in your magazine. I received two complimentary issues, and I mailed my subscription back, but I haven't received any other issues as of yet.
Well, I tell you, we have... One of the problems with a startup magazine is you have these little glitches, and we have had a fulfillment problem lately that we are solving. So I think that you would be able to expect to get your magazines very shortly, and we will certainly make good on the back issues too.
Tell us a little bit more about how you, some of the articles in here. There's an article that you mentioned Clarence Page wrote about the politics of crossover. How did you decide to go from that angle on that article?
Well, the obvious news hook were the election of Douglas Wilder in Virginia and in New York City, the election of the first black mayor, David Dinkins. And what sort of haunted both campaigns was the specter of old-time aggressive black demands, as opposed to a new style sort of working within the system. And we wanted to examine what went into the success of these campaigns, and raise the question, what do you give up? The conclusion is we have to see what you give up. I mean, you have to sort of see how things work out in the course of the administrations.
In looking at the current coverage of Mayor Marion Barry's problems here in Washington, some critics have said that the media is going after him purely based on race, that it's a question of race. And yet Juan Williams of the Washington Post, whom you mentioned as a contributor to your magazine, is quoted in an article as saying, "There's a tendency at the Washington Post to hold Mayor Barry to a lower standard than other politicians." You have a reaction to that?
A lower standard. What I do have a reaction to is that I think one of the things that we haven't seen in coverage of Mayor Barry, except in a couple of places, I think Juan Williams and Roger Wilkins have talked about how, in a sense, he has the situation goes against a lot of things that the civil rights movement and black folks have worked for. It's when there's a particular kind of scandal involved with drugs, when that's what is plaguing our community. You know, it can be perceived as a slap in the face, and we haven't felt comfortable in talking about that. And one of the hallmarks I think of Emerge is that we will talk about some of these difficult issues, some things that we feel anxiety. We have felt in the past anxiety about discussing, which makes sense when you've been on the shorter end in the power equation. You're always concerned about what could be used against you. And I think one of the perspectives that this younger generation, this emerging generation of blacks who've been beneficiaries of the hard work that's gone on before, is that we're raising the question, you know, maybe the power equation is changing, not as rapidly as we might like, but it is changing, and we have to change our mode of operation along with that. So it's sort of an experimental thing, and there are risks attended, but I think there's progress that goes along with the risk as well.
Phoenix, Arizona, good morning.
Good morning. Oh, I really, truly enjoy C-SPAN. It has been educational, informative. It teaches you your history, your geography. But the main thing I want to talk to the lady today about, I would like to receive her magazine, and I haven't seen it in Phoenix. And one thing I would like for you, I'm so full of it. I would like for you to do an article on Jesse Jackson to let the American people know that there are people, black people, that he does not speak for. And I would like for you to stress special to Buchanan that he do not speak for all black people. That I do think that there should be a consideration of the District of Columbia of being a state. There is, democracy is open up all over the world. And yet he has the nerve to deny people in the United States the opportunity to give their opinion why they think it should be a 51st state. The other night I heard him, and it was so disgusting, so demoralizing to the black race, as if, Jesse, what is Jesse going to do? It seemed to be a conversation that all journalists want to know, especially in Anglo-Saxon, what Jesse wants to do. We as a black people, he do not represent all black people. And I come from the sit-in area of the early 60s. I am in my 60s. And I can speak from being a part of the sit-in, a part of the change in times in America. We have gained a lot, and we have lost a lot. But I see no reason for him to, Buchanan, to keep on downtrodden the black race. I have never heard him say anything nice about the black race.
Thank you, ma'am, for your call. Reaction to that?
Well, what I'd like to respond to is, there's a tendency, the media lights tend to highlight one black leader. That's a problem that we've had traditionally. I mean, even as far back, with the Civil Rights Movement, there was Martin Luther King, and Malcolm X was in the shadows, but he was someone who the black community was interested in. It is true there are a range of perspectives, political perspectives in the black community, a range of political ideologies. And we recognize that in the magazine. In the February issue, we have Malcolm X on the cover. In the March issue, we focus on blacks in the GOP. And the story by George Curry focuses on a small but increasing number of vocal young people who are looking to the Republican Party as a vehicle of self-determination and political statement for the black community from their perspective. So there are a range of ideologies and different leaders that represent those different perspectives. And that's the kind of thing that we hope to cover and emerge, the whole spectrum.
Saginaw, Michigan. Go ahead, please.
I'd like to commend Ms. McHenry and Mr. Ames for outstanding and meritorious attempt to mobilize our community and raise the country's level of awareness of the meritorious contributions people of African descent have made to the progress of humanity as a whole. People like Malcom X's contribution will never be fully appreciated when you realize that it's about the moral imperative of each of us is asking what we can do to be part of the solution to rectify the genocide. That means the things taken in totality, the effect of all African-American people, the fact that we have the highest infant mortality rate, the context of what happened to the Jews was like they call that a Holocaust. But the magnitude of the destruction of our people is still being perpetuated through the mediocrity in the school system. We must build our own institutions. We must empower every African-American child, regardless of their socioeconomic level. We must use every means within our disposal, print media, television media, every means of communication possible to have a solidarity that transcends all organizational differences to empower our people politically, economically, in totality, especially spiritually, because we have to have a moral imperative. Each of us.
Thank you, sir, for your call.
I think what this caller is touching upon that we're very concerned about at Emerge Magazine are the really difficult problems that we're facing in our community and what we can do among ourselves to address them. They're almost overwhelming. In future months, you'll see a really gripping attempt to come to terms with the problem of poverty and drugs in the community. The other thing is our educational system is failing, especially our inner city children, and we're going to be highlighting some of the experts who are really taking a look at that. And figuring out what works and how you replicate the successes that may be happening in various communities around the country.
East Brunswick, New Jersey, you're on the air.
Yes, I'm really enjoying your program. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Ms. Or the guest, it's okay to say African American.
Yes, it is.
Because the color black, if you notice in the dominant culture, always depicts negative things and I'm an African. I'm proud of it, because if you know your real history as an African, you can't be proud of being an African. We were here before everybody else. The mother of all of us comes from our continent, so we were the chosen people. Be proud. Call yourself an African American. Be comfortable with it. It's okay.
And we
keep
do.
Up the good
we
work.
Do in Emerge. We actually use African American and black interchangeably. Acknowledging both our cultural heritage, but also acknowledging the racial distinctions that this society makes.
Goldsboro, North Carolina, you're on C-SPAN.
Yes, I would like to comment about your magazine. I think it's an excellent magazine.
Thank you.
Not only for a certain class of people or a certain age of people, and I found the last magazine that I received yesterday to be a very good magazine, and my concern for myself is I'm trying to become a professional person, okay, and I would like to see more articles on how to achieve not only for going to college or anything like that, but for I'm encountering some racial prejudices here, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And I hope your magazine will touch on, for a person to make it in this world. make it in North, well, especially in the southern United States.
Well, we will be instituting some new columns. I mean, like I say, we've just closed the sixth issue of the magazine, and we're still fine-tuning our presentation. But one of the columns that we will be adding is a career perspectives column, and we will be addressing strategic things that black professionals face in the marketplace that have to do with race, but also other just basic hard information of a general nature that you will need to have to succeed in your profession. So we will be focusing on professional information in future issues of the magazine.
Helena Montana, good morning.
I'm a white voter, and I used to support Jesse Jackson. And I've just sort of been, at the moment, I'm not very inspired by him anymore, because I feel he does more hurts the Democrats more than he helps them. I mean, like in the last presidential election, I mean, there were like three or four states that were really close, you know, and the Democrats lost. I think they were like Illinois, Pennsylvania, and Maryland. And he can't even turn out his own people to vote. You know, and I think the black people, there are many other good black leaders, and I think a lot of the black people just shouldn't support Jesse Jackson. I just, you know, that's all I have to say.
Well, there are a lot of black people who do support Jesse Jackson, but as I was saying earlier, there are lots of other emerging leaders and around the country in various communities. And we will be covering that in the magazine. One of the articles that we have in on tap for the future is an article on black mayors, because as you well realize, there's a new bumper crop from the last election, and there are some studies looking at previous generations of black mayors to see exactly how their constituents have benefited from their administrations, and you know, does a black mayor make a difference for black constituents as far as economic development and so forth? So we will be looking at all sorts of black politicians and really reporting on what they're doing and their approaches and the relative success or failure of them.
Chesapeake, Virginia, you're next.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have a little trouble with words. Discrimination, racism, and others that are used. Now, this morning in our paper, we had an article written by a black statesman who is a judge that says he has trouble with the word racism because the NAACP continually uses racism to try to get something that probably they should be using another word. And he comes up with a new word to the president of the National Association of Administrators of Colored People that lets doism. In other words, the opportunities are there. We can do it.
Oh, I see.
We keep fussing about everything that goes wrong and automatically becomes this word that he don't like and I don't particularly like, racist. I think we all have the same opportunities. And we can do the same thing, and we work together. I'd like to hear your comment, please.
Well, this is part of a continuing dialogue that the African-American community is having, recognizing that legal segregation has been removed, and many of those legal barriers have been removed. There's still attitudes in the society that we have to contend with, even though you know, we may be able to get a job in a certain place, but there's a differential with how fast you're able to advance and so forth. The thing is, how do you talk about this new set of circumstances? And it's very interesting that somebody has decided that they want a new word for racism. I'm not sure that a new word for racism addresses the situation, but I understand the impulse. The impulse is to say things are different than they were 20 years ago. But how do you acknowledge the problems that are, you know, the new set of problems that a new situation brings and the new set of responsibilities that a new situation brings, and address them without sort of being a broken record about the past. And I do understand what that impulse is about. And like I said, that is a continuing dialogue in the African-American community and something that we'll hear a lot about in the 90s.
Columbia, South Carolina, you're next.
Yes, hello. How are you doing today?
Fine. How are you?
I have a couple of questions for her. First of all, I'm hoping that you don't follow the guidelines of the Johnson product, Ebony and Jet magazine, because I don't particularly like those magazines because they are stale in their presentation to the black community. What I would like for you to do, is it possible in the future that you can do an article on black-on-black crime in the corporate structure? Because I dealt with the corporate, I don't want to call the company's name, but I dealt in a situation where there was a lot of hatred towards blacks, each other, in the corporate structure. And, you know...
You're talking about in a black company?
No, this company is a white company that has a black division, see, and there was a lot of, you know, a lot of personal quights and problems and stuff, and they set people up to get fired, such as myself, and not knowing what was going on because I just walked into this company and stuff, and that's something that's been not dealt with over the years since we just became in a situation where we have black divisions in major corporations and stuff, and there's a lot of problems because people turn around and they do things against each other because a lot of stuff we do to ourselves, and it's not talked about in the public. And the second thing I want to ask you about, I get your comments on that too, is that I've wanted to find out when you interview artists, recording artists, such as Michael Jackson or Prince, why I have never seen, and I've always asked, why don't an interview ask, well, Mr. Lionel Richie, why don't you hire any blacks on your crew? Why don't you hire any black manager? There are competent black managers, lawyers, technicians, road crews, and everything else. Same thing with New Edition and the rest of these artists out here. They all have white management. They all have white roadies. They all have white everything. But their money is coming from the black community. And I'd like to hear your comments on that. And thank you very much.
Thank you. To deal with your second question first, as a matter of fact, that's a theme that we raised in our very first issue of Emerge in an article by Nelson George, Black Music Fade to White. He was actually talking about the white musicians who were becoming million sellers on singing black music, but not exactly singing authentic black music. And he was examining that trend. But the other thing was he was raising the question of a black infrastructure in the music industry. You know, black artists making money for, you know, predominantly white corporations. But not using the opportunity with the money that they're generating to bring other folks in, other black folks in, and giving them an opportunity to build their expertise in the area of accounting or law or whatever. That is something that a trend that we're watching and following and reporting on. Now, let's see, your first question was?
Black on black crime and corporate structure.
Oh, it's interesting. You obviously feel very strongly about the set of social dynamics that you're meeting, and it's something that I've heard about. I mean, the social dynamics of when you're a small group of black professionals in a larger white structure, responding to pressures by not being cooperative with each other. Those are the kinds of things that we hope to address in our career perspectives coverage in future issues. Yes, we will be doing that. And I'm noting that you're calling it black-on-black crime. That's very interesting.
What do you mean by that? It's an interesting term.
Well, I'm noting that black-on-black crime, he feels very strongly that this is really... a negative thing to the extent that he wants to call it a crime. So I am noting that.
Grand County, Utah. Go ahead, please.
Yes, it's nice to talk to a couple of lovely ladies this morning. C-SPAN really does a good job. He asked me if I'd call in the last 30 days. I don't know whether I have or not. I don't think anybody can get into these Piper programs within 30 days. Maybe some do. I'd like to visit with you a little bit. 1964, I was at the state convention in Denver, and I met George Brown was speaking when I finally decided to run for Colorado House of Representatives. And wonder if you could tell me, California got elected a black governor that year, and George was actually the first because the polls closed quicker than Colorado. I think he's back in Washington, but who and what was the governor of California's name?
A black governor of California? I'm not aware of what you're talking about. Because my recollection is that Mayor Tom Bradley ran for governor of California and lost. I don't think California's hit that milestone yet, and I'm looking forward to the day when they do.
Youngstown, Ohio. Go ahead, please.
Well, I just wanted to point out how I feel about racism, which I think is a very elusive term. A lot of times people are confusing racism for something that's really a social issue. If you're poor and stuck in the ghetto, or not, let's just say the lower class, you don't necessarily have to be in the ghetto. But opportunity is hard to find. Job opportunity, schooling, even the schools you go to have pathetic education in most conditions. So with that in mind, you got to look at the fact that the United States is allowing jobs to leave this country 20, 30, 50 years ago that would have stayed in this country by investing in the third world market that's out there. So it's actually, I would say, the government is failing us and would like to let us blame it on racism. It's easier, and it's easier to deal with. Like I said, I think it's very elusive. And then I'd like to point out some what I consider anti-racism. All right, let's take what happened to Rooney there. All right, now Rooney's in all kind of trouble for making a black racist statement. From who? What's the source? A gay magazine says this about him. Why are they all of a sudden credible? And why is their word more important than Rooney's? And another instance I'd like to point out is Jesse Jackson. If he were a white man, would he have a chance for the mayor of Washington, D.C.? Thank you for letting me speak.
Racism is an elusive phenomenon. Again, as I was saying earlier, with the demise of legal racism, we're still left with the residue of people's feelings and with, you know, the law, the operation of long-time social structures. And also there's interaction with economics and with other kinds of political considerations and forces. It's a very, very complicated phenomenon. And that is the reason that we're trying to write more sophisticated commentary on the subject to sort of acknowledge some of the distinctions and differences that we're meeting in the 90s that we didn't even think about in the 60s.
Another one of his comments was, "Would Jesse Jackson have a chance to become mayor of D.C. if he were white?"
Would Jesse Jackson have a chance to become mayor of D.C. if he were white? Well, I think with the whole impulse, with D.C. being a predominantly black city, I think we're looking to black leaders. And that's the way I would look at that question, that we're trying to develop the political talent in our community. So it would be he would have a chance if he were speaking to the concerns of black people. He would be having to speak very directly and forthrightly, more so than most other white politicians these days.
Sacramento, California. Good morning.
Good morning. Am I on now?
Yes, you are.
Oh, I'm looking at you right now, and this is absolutely terrific. Listen, I live right here. I live in a condo, and I have good neighbors, which are black, okay? And you know what I like about this whole situation? Them as neighbors, as they don't look at a person as black or white. They look at me as my neighbors. They don't say, hey, brother, I think that a lot of the biggest problem what I see with this whole thing is that the blacks segregate themselves. In other words, they call themselves African-Americans. Why? Why aren't they just Americans? I'm a Norwegian. I don't tell people, well, I'm a Norwegian-American. Hey, I'm just Wes. I'm just, you know, like, why does that have to be? That we don't, the Japanese, the Chinese, the Norwegians, the Swedes, the Irish, the Scots, we don't take and set ourselves aside. Just because I'm white, I don't run over to my friend and say, hey, brother, you know, in other words, what I'm trying to say is, why segregate yourself? I love these people. These neighbors, they're the best people that I can ever have, you know? So I want to hang up and get your comment. Thank you so much. I love it.
Well, I'm happy to hear a testimony to multiracial neighborhoods, that it's a situation that can comfortably work. It can, and I think it needs to happen more. And I think that is the reason that, when you speak of blacks segregating ourselves, it's not so much that we are segregating ourselves as that society responds to us. I mean, the first thing, maybe they don't respond to you as a Norwegian American when they see you walk into the room, but I know that when I walk into the room, they say, there's a black woman, before they know anything else about me. That's the first thing they see. So when the society responds to you in that way, you look at, what is that quality? And come to do is to value the cultural background that represents, and to honor the cultural background that represents. And that's why we proudly refer to ourselves as African American.
Do you have a sense of the demographics of who is reading your magazine at this point? Have you done some studies in that regard?
We're just doing our first reader study. We have, in fact, in the March issue that's coming out, there's a survey that we're asking people to return. I can only tell you what our target is so far, that it's the baby boomer group, age 25 to 49, college educated, professional, earning, of course, the black middle class. We do a lot more with a lot less money, because we talk about our income as $25,000 and above. That would strike many people as not quite a middle class income, but one of the things that we have learned how to do over the years is build security with less resources. And so that, I think that pretty much characterizes the group that we're going after. Oh, and it's also a dual audience, men and women, families. This is very much a magazine that will be in households, we presume.
Well, Susan McHenry, Managing Editor of Emerge Magazine, we thank you for joining us this morning.
Well, thank you for having me.
To our viewers, we thank you for watching, and thanks for your calls, and have a good day.
For more information about Emerge